لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فلما فصل تالوت بالجنود قال إن الله مبتليكم بنهر فمن شرب منه فليس مني ومن لم يطعمه فإنه مني إلا من اغترف غرفة بيده فشربوا منه إلا قليلا منهم فلما جاوزه هو والذين آمنوا معه قالوا لا طاقة لنا اليوم بجالوت وجنوده قال الذين يظنون أنهم ملاقوا الله كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله والله مع الصابرين صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي فلما فصل تالوت بالجنود when تالوت عليه الصلاة والسلام went forth with his army, Junood with his armies. قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مُبْتَلِيكُمْ بِنَهَرٍ He said to his people, Allah is going to test you with a river. The river Jordan, now it's very important, everybody knows it. This was in between and they crossed river Jordan. فَمَنْ شَرِبَ مِنْهُ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي Whosoever will drink from that river, he is not from me. He is not our companion. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَطْعَمْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي And whosoever doesn't drink from the water of that river, he is from me, he is my companion. إِلَّا مَنْ اِغْتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِهِ Except those who scoop a handful with their own hands. Take some water in the hand, in the hollow of the hand, and take it. That is only permissible, but not drinking. فَشَرِبُوا مِنْهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا مِنْهُ All of them merely drank from the water of the river, except only a few from themselves. فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَهُ هُوَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ When they had crossed the river, Himself, that is Hazrat Talut, and people who believed with him, قالوا, they said, لا طاقة لنا اليوم بجالوت وجنوده. They said, we don't have the strength today to face Goliath, Jalut, وجنوده and his armies. They are very strong. They were scared. قال الذين يظنون أنهم ملاقوا الله Those people from among them who had the conviction that they will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one day, they said to them, Kam min fiyatin qaleelatin ghalabat fiyatan kaseeratan. How often a small party has overcome a large party by Allah's leave, by Allah's permission. Wallahu ma'as sabreen. And Allah is with those who show patience and perseverance. Now please try to understand the background. Why the people were put to this test? Actually, before any confrontation, before any armed conflict, the commander of the army must know the condition of the people, of the army, of the soldiers, their morale, their discipline, listening and obeying. These things also They mean a lot, not only physical number, physical strength, not only the arms, but the state of morale of the people. And then you know the discipline, that if a command is given, if order is given, whether it is obeyed or not, whether the people have necessary self-control or not. So that was a test to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his appointed king, he put this army to test. And most of them failed. We have the example in the consultation with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He held that meeting of consultation before Badr also. He put a question, we shall read in Surah Al-Anfal, that now there is a caravan coming from the north with lot of wealth, merchandise, and an army is coming from the south. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised that He will give us victory over one of them. Which way should we proceed? Why this question? The same purpose, to see the morale of the people. Some of them said we should go towards the caravan because the booty will be great, we shall have great wealth, and you know only a few guards are there with the caravan. It will be easy to kill them, to rout them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended something else. He wanted that there should be a direct confrontation between the Quraysh and the Muslims. So this is actually the example. But most of the people at their consultation, they said, O Prophet, what you have in your mind, you proceed in that direction. Why are you asking us? You have to make the decision. Which way you go, we are with you. So that is actually the same thing is happening here before this. This is the battle of Badr of the former Muslim Ummah. Please keep this point in mind. وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لَجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ And when they lined against the armies of Jalut, they said, قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَصَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ Now they prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching the Muslim, now you pray this. This is the prayer being taught to you before Badr. You must learn the prayer. رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا O our Lord, pour out perseverance on us. وَصَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا Make our feet firm. وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ And help us against this nation, these people who are kuffar, who are unbelieving. فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ They routed them with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ And Dawood killed Jalut. There is a long story. Dawood was not in the army of Jalut, of Talut. He was a shepherd with his, you know, flock of sheep, etc. But he incidentally came at the scene of that battle, what was happening. And he saw that from this army of Talut, nobody is taking the courage to go and confront Jalut. He was calling, send someone who can fight me. That was the usual method of battles in those days, personal wrestling, personal combat. But nobody dared going forward. Then Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam, he himself volunteered him and he killed Jalut. And that way Dawood became important. And Saul or Talut gave him his daughter in marriage and he became closely related to Talut. And then after Talut he became the king. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the prophethood and the knowledge and the wisdom also. So he had the physical strength, as much physical strength as he could dare confront Jalut and kill Jalut. فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ In the same way, in the battle of Ahzab, there is one very brave person, and he was from the Kuffar, Amr ibn Abd Wad, and Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, he killed him. Otherwise, it was said about him that nobody can confront him. Abd Wad, Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, who came forward, and he killed him and slayed him. فَهَزَمُوهُمْ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَقَتَلَ دَاوُودُ جَالُوتَ وَآتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Dawood the kingdom, wisdom, وَعَلَّمَهُ بِمَّا يَشَاءُ And He taught him whatever he liked. وَلَوْلَا دَفُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ. And had it not been that Allah Ta'ala has been removing one people by another, had it not been so, لَفَسَدَتِ الْأَرْضِ, the whole of the earth would have corrupted. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ ذُو فَضْلٍ عَلَى النَّاسِ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ. But Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is bountiful to the worlds. تِلْكَ آيَاتُ اللَّهِ نَتْلُوهَا عَلَيْكَ بِالْحَقِّ. These are the signs of Allah, ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are reciting them to you. Now this is the saying of the angels. The angel has brought this ayat and he is saying now, tilka ayatullah. This is actually the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Natluha alayka bilhaq. Which we are reciting unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with haq, with truth. وَإِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. And verily, surely, definitely, you are from among the messengers of Allah. تِلْكَ الرُّسُلُ فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. These are the messengers of Allah. فَضَّلْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَىٰ بَعْضٍ. We have raised some of them over the others. مِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَلَّمَ اللَّهِ. From among them there was one with whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked and spoke directly. That is Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wa salam. With whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke many a times on the Mount of Tur. Minhum man kallam Allah wa rafa'a ba'dahum darajat. And he raised some of them in degrees, in different various forms. Wa atayna Isa ibn Maryam al-bayyanat. And we gave Isa, Jesus, son of Mary, Maryam, alayhim as-salam, al-bayyanat, very clear signs, very big miracles, wa'ayyadnahu biruhil qudus. And we helped him, supported him with the Holy Spirit, Hazrat Jibreel, alayhi salatu was-salam. Walau sha'allahu maqtatal al-lazina min ba'dihim. And had Allah decreed, desired or willed, then those people who were after them would not have quarreled with each other. Followers of the prophets, different prophets, quarreling with each other. The biggest enmity today is between the Muslims and the Jews. Although if you take into consideration all the aspects, they should be the closest communities on the surface of the world. We believe in Torah, we believe in Moses, we believe in Jesus. These three religions should be very close to each other. But the most bitter, and then these Jews, the practicing Jews, they are the closest in culture to the Muslims. The same beards, the same covering of the heads, although now it has reduced in size. But you know, there is the remnant. The same law, the same things, swine, haram, forbidden, they don't eat it. Then you know the kosher meat, it must be halal, it must be zabiha. All these things, you know, closest. Law of Moses, law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The closest to each other throughout the world. But the enmity, the most bitter enmity. In the same way, Jesus, he was a Jew himself. He was born of Mary. Who was she? She was from Israel, the same progeny. Now you know, the most bitter enmity has been throughout these 2,000 years, nearly 2,000 years, between the Christians and the Jews. You read the history. How much persecuted the Jews have been at the hands of the Christians. First of all, the Christians were persecuted at the hands of the Jews, and then the Jews were persecuted at the hands of the Christians. After Emperor Constantine, he embraced Christianity, he became a Christian. Now Christianity was the state religion of a very big empire, the Roman Empire. And now there was tough time for the Jews throughout the Roman Empire. So this has been the case, the closest people regarding the prophets, the same progeny of Yaqub alayhi salatu was salam, But the followers are bitter enemies of each other. The same prophets from the progeny of Ibrahim. Ibrahim and his son Ismail and in his progeny Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Muslims believe in him. But the bitterest enemies. لَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَقْتَتَلَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. Had Allah will so, people after them would not have quarreled and fought each other. مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاتْهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ. After that, the clear signs and teachings had come to them. وَلَكِنْ اِخْتَلَفُوا فَمِنْهُمْ. But they differed. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ آمَنَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ كَفَرْ. From among them are those who came to believe, who had the faith. وَمِنْهُمْ And from among them also are those مَنْ كَفَرْ. Who denied, who belied. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ مَا اقْتَتَلُوا. Had Allah willed so, they would not have quarreled or fought each other. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَفْعَلُ مَا يُرِيدُ. But Allah does what He decrees, what He wills, what He pleases. He has created this world, He has given the option. This ikhtilaf, this difference will remain. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا بِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ. I told you the two strands of jihad fi sabilillah, infaq again. These two sections were for qital. But that qital was from the past history. The battle between Jalut and Talut. But in between the lines, it was actually a preparation, mental preparation of the Muslims for the coming battle of Badr. History was going to repeat very soon. And from Badr was going to start the glorious period of the Islamic history, of the Muslim history. Muslims suddenly became a very big power to reckon with. They defeated Quraysh. You can't imagine the effect over the whole of the Arabian Peninsula. Quraysh defeated at the hands of Muhammad and his followers. A handful, a very small number, nearly unarmed. They defeated the Quraysh, the mightiest force in the whole Arabian Peninsula. So actually that was very decisive. That is why it has been called in the Quran, Yawmul Furqan, the differentiating day. It is a dividing day. Tables were turned after Badr. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا. After qital there must be infaq also, side by side. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. Oh, you who profess to believe, expend from whatever we have given you, whatever we have provided you. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ لَا بَيْعٌ فِيهِ وَلَا خُلَّةٌ وَلَا شَفَاعَةٌ. Before that day comes, that is the day of judgment, when there shall be no bargaining, no friendship, no intercession whatsoever. This is a very categorical ayah. The import of this ayah is the same as of two ayat which we have already read before. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمَ اللَّهَ تَجْزِي نَفْسٌ عَنْ نَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَلَا يُخَذُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ وَلَا هُمْ يُنصَرُونَ. In the beginning of the sixth section, and then in the beginning of the 15th section. Here again you find, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Muslims. Just as the address to Jews was also, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ, in the end of the fifth section. And the Muslims were also addressed with the same words, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ, in the beginning of the 19th section. In the same way, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ. Before that day comes, that day dawns, when there will be no bargaining, no trading, no friendship, no intercession. وَالْكَافِرُونَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. And those who deny, they are the wrongdoers, they are the unjust people, they are the evil people. اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُ. Now comes Ayatul Kursi, the greatest ayah of the Quran. And there are clear ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidatu ayatil Quran. This ayah, a very big ayah, very long ayah, is the chief of the all the ayat of the Quran. And this is a very big prayer of tawheed. توحید صفاتی اور دی ایٹریبیوٹس آف اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ، دی بیسک ایٹریبیوٹس، توحید آف دی ایٹریبیوٹس ان دی ڈسکرپشن اینڈ نریشن آف دی توحید آف ایٹریبیوٹس آف اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ، دس از دی موسٹ پروفاؤنڈ آیا آف دی قرآن. اللہ لا الہ الا ہو، اللہ از ہی، that there is no ilah, no god beside him. Al-Hayyul Qayyum, he is ever living, self-sustaining, and he is the sustainer of all the existence. La ta'khudhuhu sinatun wala nawm, neither slumber nor sleep can seize him. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ، to him belongs everything that is in the skies and heavens and that is on the earth. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ، who is he who can dare intercede before him except after his permission. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ، he knows what is before them all and what is after them and what is behind them. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ، and they cannot encompass anything from his knowledge. إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ، except what he himself pleases to give. Nobody, no creature, no paygamber, no messenger, no prophet, no angel, none can have any knowledge except the knowledge that has been given to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. We have read that ayah, Subhanaka la ilma lana illa ma'allamtana. All the angels have said, glory be to you, we don't have any knowledge except the knowledge that you gave to us. There's no knowledge except the knowledge which Allah gives to anybody. لَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَئِن مِنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ وَسْعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ، his throne or his kingdom, it is translated in two ways, his throne or his kingdom extends over all the skies and heavens and over whole of the earth. وَلَا يَعُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا، and he is never fatigued by guarding both of them, the skies and the earth and the earth. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ، and he is the high, al-ali, and he is the mighty, al-azim. لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينِ، there is no complex compulsion in religion or in deen. What does it mean? No person will be compelled to embrace Islam. No person has ever been compelled to accept Islam. But as regards the system, if the Muslims have power, they will never tolerate any unjust system and social order to prevail. There we shall use force. Individuals, a different case. Anybody, if he wants to remain a Hindu, remain a Hindu. You don't want to remain a Christian, you remain a Christian. But the system will be changed. The rule will be of Allah. حَتَّى يُوْتُ الْجِزْيَةَ عَيَّدِهِمْ وَهُمْ صَاغِرُونَ، you can remain a Hindu, a Christian, a Buddhist, or whosoever you may be, you can remain. But you will have to submit to the Islamic State, to the Khilafah, and there you will have to pay the taxes, the jizya. That is the position. But individually you will not be compelled to change your religion. That is actually the position of Islam. It is usually misunderstood. As far as the system is concerned, the collective system, the social order, that if we have power and we want to attain power to change it, that is called revolution. We are working for Islamic revolution to establish the system of Khilafah. Sovereignty to Allah and Khilafah for the Muslims. That will be the system. لا اکراہ فی الدین قد تبین الرشد من الغی. The right path has become distinct from the wrong path. فَمَنْ يَغْفِرْ بِالْتَاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِنْ بِاللَّهِ. So whoever disowns Taghut, what is Taghut? Everything which is rebellious against Allah is Taghut. Every institution which doesn't accept divine sovereignty and authority is Taghut. The non-Islamic state is the biggest Taghut on earth. Taghut are not only individuals, the systems are Taghut. Taga, what does it mean? Taga. When you have transgressed your limits, you are Taghi. Taga means to go beyond the limits. You must be a bondsman to Allah, you should be a servant to Allah, you must obey Allah. You were created for His ibadah. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. If instead of being servant of Allah, you become master. I am the ruler. I have the sovereignty. You are in revolt against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are Taghut. So you have to deny Taghut first. And then you should have faith in Allah. You have to say La ilaha first. And then illallah. Denial is first. Affirmation comes after that. The same is the thing here. Whosoever denies, declares that he is free from this taghut, and then he believes in Allah. فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. So he has grasped in his hand a firm handhold. لَنْفِسَامَ لَهَا, which will never give way. وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ, and Allah is all listening, all knowing. اللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Allah is the protector and helper and guardian. Wali, you know, is a very profound word of Arabic. You can't translate it, can't give its connotation in one word in English. Allah is the protector and the guardian and the supporter of those who have real faith. يُخْرِجَهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. He keeps them taking out from various shades of darkness into light. Zulumat, always you will find in Quran in plural. There are different shades of darkness. There is shirk, there is kufr, there is nifaq, there is ilhad. So many shades, different shades of darkness. Light is one. And darkness has different shades. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always keeps bringing them out from the shades of the darkness into light. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاهُمُ الطَّاغُوتُ. As for those who don't believe, who disbelieve, their supporters are the Taghut. They are the brothers and supporters. There is a mutual support. They are supporting Taghut and Taghut is helping them. يُخْرِجُونَهُمْ مِنَ النُّورِ إِلَى الظُّلُمَاتِ. And these Taghut, they keep on taking them away from light into different shades of darknesses. This is the process going on side by side. اللَّهُ وَلِيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. اللَّهُمَّ رَبَّنَا اجْعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ. اللَّهُمَّ رَبَّنَا اجْعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ. May Allah include us in these people whose wali is Allah Himself. And He takes them out from this different shades of darkness into light. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَوْلِيَاهُمُ الطَّاغُوتُ يُخْرِجُونَهُمْ مِنَ النُّورِ إِلَى الظُّلُمَاتِ. اللَّهُمَّ رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ. أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. They are the people of fire and they will remain in that forever. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فِي رَبِّهِ. Again the same word, أَلَمْ تَرَ. Did you never ponder about the person الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, who argued with Ibrahim, fi rabbihi, about his Lord, his Rabb. Who is your Rabb? Now this person is Namrud, the king of Iraq, at the time of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. Namrud was also a title. Does that sit on? Faraina. The kings of Misr, of Egypt, they were Faraina. The kings of Babylonia, which we now call Iraq, they were Namarida. So actually Namrud and Fir'aun, they are not names, they are titles. Just as Fir'aun, Namrud. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. So as we say, Fir'aun of Moses. So Namrud of Ibrahim, of the time of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. Hazrat Ibrahim was presented in the court of the king. There, there's this dialogue went on. أَنْ أَعْتَاهُ اللَّهُ الْمُلْكُ. He was arguing about God, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the Rabb of Ibrahim, only because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had gave him the kingship. He became arrogant. He himself claimed to be God. I am the authority. Just as, you know, the Fir'aun of Egypt had said, Ana Rabbukum al-Ala, Alay Salimul Kumisr. It's not for me the kingdom of Egypt. وَهَذِهِ الْأَنْهَارُ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِي. All this irrigation system is under my control. I will allow water to only those whom I please. It is all under my, in my head, under me. In the same way, he was the master of his country. إِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّيَ الَّذِي يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ. When Ibrahim said, alayhi salatu wasalam, my Lord is he who gives life and puts death. قَالَ أَنَا أُحْيِي وَأُمِيتُ. He said, I have these powers also. And the tradition goes that he fetched and called two people who had been condemned. They were in the prison. That sentence had been passed on them. Called them in the court. The one he set free, I have given him life. The other he instantly, he ordered to be slain. Him I have killed. I have the authority. Now Hazrat Ibrahim said, قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْتِي بِالشَّمْسِ مِنَ الْمَشْرِقِ. My God, my Allah, I believe in that God, in that Allah, who makes the sun rise from the east. فَاتِي بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ. If you claim to be God, if you claim to have authority, now just you order the sun to rise from the west. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ. At this, that kafir remained confounded. He couldn't say anything. وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِ الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And Allah doesn't give guidance to such evildoers, such unjust people. أَوْ كَالَّذِي مَرَّ عَلَىٰ قَرْيَةٍ. This is another incident, and most probably it concerns also the history of the Jews, the Bani Israel. When Nebuchadnezzar destroyed Jerusalem in the late 7th century before Jesus, B.C., before Christ, he killed about 600,000 Jews. And the rest of 600,000, rest 600,000, he took them to Babylonia in captivity. They remained there, some for 100 years, some for 150 years. That's the worst period of Jewish history, era of days of captivity in Babylonia. Jerusalem was ruined, absolutely ruined. Not a single soul living, not a single wall, not two bricks together. Such was the ruination of a city. Just imagine how big a city it was. It was founded by Solomon, Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, at the height of the glory and splendor of Bani Israel. That was the town. And Hazrat Sulaiman had the help of the jinns also in construction. He constructed the Haikal, the Solomon's temple. And then this was raised to the ground. Now two bricks were intact. Not a single soul was there. And then thereby passed the Prophet Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam. He wondered at that scene. How can this city again be revived? How can Allah revive this city? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put him to death, kept him there for 100 years in that death condition, then revived him. And then, you know, this is the matter. Then Hazrat Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam, he went to Babylonia. And then, you know, he started his call, repent, make tawbah towards Allah. And due to his call and his mission, there was the spiritual revival of Bani Israel. And then they again were given, you know, another period of glory during their history. And that is called the Bakkabi power, the Bakkabi Sultanate. That was the second rise that they had during their history. Anyhow, about this incident now, Hazrat Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam, I feel it personally that this, although the name has not been given here, only one city and a person, but you know, this seems to me, I'm pretty sure that this is the case of Hazrat Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam. Aw kallazi marra ala qaryatin. Or have you ever considered the case of that person who passed by a town, وَهِيَ خَابِيَةٌ عَلَىٰ عُرُوشِهَا, and that town had fallen down upon its roofs, all was demolished. قَالَ أَنَّا يُحْيِي هَذِهِ اللَّهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. He said, how shall Allah give this town again life after it has been dead, so badly dead, so deeply ruined? فَأَمَاتَهُ اللَّهُ مِئَةَ عَامٍ. So Allah put him to death for 100 years. ثُمَّ بَعَثَ. Then Allah again brought him to life, raised him alive. قَالَ كَمْ لَبِثْتَ. Allah asked him, how long have you been here? Do you have any idea? Oh, Uzair, supposedly if he was Uzair alayhi salatu wasalam, oh, Uzair, do you have any idea how long have you been here? قَالَ لَبِثْتُ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ. He said, I've been here for one day, or maybe a part of a day. Just I had a nap. I just had, you know, a nap and nothing else. Maybe a full day has passed, and maybe a part of it. قَالَ بَلْ لَبِسْتَ مِيَةَ عَامٍ. Allah said, no. You have been here in this condition for 100 years. فَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ طَعَامِكَ. Now see to your food that you had with you. وَشَرَابِكَ. And the drink that you had, لَمْ يَتَسَنَّهْ, they have not spoiled. I have kept them as fresh as they were before 100 years. This is my authority, I can do it. This is in my power, I am all powerful. وَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ. And now on the other hand, you see, just look to your ass, your donkey. And that had died, you know, and all flesh has gone. And there were only few bones scattered and nothing else. 100 years. So all those physical phenomena had happened to that dog, to that ass, but nothing had happened to the food. وَنْظُرْ إِلَىٰ حِمَارِكَ وَلِنَجْعَلَكَ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ. And we want to make you a sign for the people. And it's very clear, when he had returned to the people, to Bani Israel, they must have been astonished. This person, he was dead long before. We had no news of him. Therefrom he has come now. And when he must have told this story, so it would have been, I think, a very, very big sign that, you know, Allah can revive us also. If he could do this to an individual, he could do this, you can do this to a community, to a nation. وَلِنَجْعَلَكَ آيَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَانْظُرْ إِلَى الطَّعَامِ وَانْظُرْ إِلَى الْعِظَامِ. And now see, look, to the bones of your donkey, of your ass, كَيْفَ نُنْشِزُهَا, how we raise them up, join them together, raise them up as a skeleton, ثُمَّ نَكْسُوهَا لَحْمًا, and then we clothe them with flesh, with muscles, فَلَمَّا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ, when everything became absolutely clear to him, قَالَ أَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Then he said and proclaimed, now I fully know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful and he can do anything that he likes. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. And just recall the time when Ibrahim said to his Lord, O Lord, let me see, show me How you will revive the dead? How will you raise the dead again to life? قَالَ وَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ. Allah asked, do you not believe? قَالَ بَلَىٰ. He said, why not? I believe. I have the faith. وَلَكِنْ لَيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. But I want that I should have the conviction, deepest conviction. My heart should be absolutely at rest. There shouldn't be an iota of doubt in me. So because I want that total and absolute conviction, that is why I have requested you to show to me. قَالَ فَخُذْ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الطَّيْرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, take four birds. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. Tame them to incline to you. Tame them so that when you call them, they respond to you, they come to you. ثُمَّ اجْعَلْ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا. Now the details are not here. The details are which are omitted. Now kill them, slaughter them, and divide their body into parts, and then part of every bird, some parts of mix them and keep them on different hills. ثُمَّ اجْعَلْ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا ثُمَّ ادْعُوهُنَّ. Then you call them the way which you had made them accustomed to respond. يَعْتِينَكَ السَّعَىٰ. You will see that they will be coming to you running. وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And you should know and keep it in mind. And you should be convinced that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is almighty, all-powerful, and He has the all-total wisdom also. Now come two sections. And they are regarding infaq fi sabilillah. How balanced, you know. Full two sections were there regarding the fighting for the cause of Allah. Although it was related to the past history of Bani Israel. Scattered ayat we have found at many places about qital. Scattered ayat have been mentioned and have appeared at many places about infaq. But two sections, full two sections about qital, we have already read. Now two sections, full two sections about infaq. مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The likeness of those who have spent their wealth and money in the way of Allah. Now this should be very clear, what does it mean in the way of Allah? Infaq fi sabilillah has a definite connotation. There is another word, sadaqah. Sadaqah is charity. Charity is basically for the poor, the needy, the miskeen, the beggar, sail. This is sadaqah. Infaq fi sabilillah is actually jihad fi sabilillah bil mal. For the cause of Allah. What's the cause of Allah? Cause of Allah is that His deen should be supreme. As the Christians pray, Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heavens. On this earth also, the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be fulfilled. The law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be enforced. This is the cause of Allah. And if you spend your money and your wealth for this purpose, this is infaq fi sabilillah. So actually, you keep it in mind. Sadaqah, infaq, itai mal, zakat, these are different terms. And every term has a definite connotation of its own. Although they can be interchanged, they can be used one in one another's place. Then qarz-e hasana, man alladhi yuqridu Allah qarzan hasana. Who is that person who can dare give Allah loan, goodly loan? And these two terms, the loan to Allah, because when you are spending for the deen of Allah, it's a loan, personal loan to Allah. When you are spending your wealth for establishing the deen of Allah, it's an infaq fi sabilillah. It's a part of jihad. Jihad fi sabilillah bil mal, that is infaq. Jihad fi sabilillah bil nafs, the final stage is qital. When you go risking your life. You go to the field of battle, risking your life. مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The similitude or likeliness of those who spend and expend their money and wealth for the cause of Allah, in the way of Allah. كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلَ. This to the likeness of a grain which grows 7 years. فِي كُلَّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ. And in each and every year there are 100 grains. So one grain of wheat, now the plant, in that are 7 years, and in every year there are 100 grains. So one grain has grown into 700 grains. The same is the similitude, that if you spend for the cause of Allah, your reward will be 700 times at least. Why at least? Because Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah will double it for whomsoever He wishes. It can be 1400 times. But that is at the discretion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. For whomsoever He pleases or wills, He will double it. وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. And Allah is all-embracing, all-knowing. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ لَا يُتْبِعُونَ مَا أَنْفَقُوا مَنًّا وَلَا أَذًى. Those who spend their maal, they spend their wealth and money fi sabilillah, in the way of Allah, summa la yutbi'una ma anfaqu, then that they don't follow what they have expended with reproach and injury. And the other meaning may be by reminding of charity and generosity. Anyhow, you know, this infaq fi sabilillah, some person will be benefiting. And it will come in the end, inshallah, who they should be. Let me explain here, so that it becomes clear through all this discussion. When there is a struggle, a revolutionary movement to establish the deen of Allah, to make it supreme, there must be certain people who become whole-time workers. Otherwise it won't work. Part-time workers cannot bring about a revolution. Part-time work can be a social service. Part-time work can be this type of thing, you know. Some education, some training, some social service. For revolutionary purpose, you must have people who are whole-time, whole-hearted, devoted fully. Otherwise there can be no revolutionary struggle. Now these people, who will support them? They also need. They must be fed. They must be looked after. Who will support them? That is why in the end of these two sections you will find who have the right of this infaq fi sabilillah. Who are the best? To whom this infaq should be given? Those who have devoted all of their life, all of their time, all of their energies to the cause of Allah. Now they have no spare time, no spare energy to spend, to earn their own livelihood. They must be supported through this infaq fi sabilillah. And now if you have given something to such a person, and now you are mentioning it to him, this is injury. This is actually aza. You have given something to them, you have helped someone of them, among them, and then you are mentioning it, and you are, you know, impressing them more and more by your generosity. So that is very pinching for them, very hurting for them. That is the thing that is discussed here. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ لَا يُتْبِعُونَ مَا أَنْفَقُوا مَنَّمْ وَلَا أَذَى. مَن, that is, to mention your charity and generosity. وَلَا أَذَى, and nothing, no injury to their feelings of self-respect and self-honor. لَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ. For them is their reward in the رَبِّهِمْ, with their Lord. وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. And there will be no fear on them, and nor will they grieve. قَالُوا مَعْرُوفٌ وَمَغْفِرَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ يَتْبَعُهَا أَذًى. A kind word and forgiveness is much better than charity followed by injury. You give something to somebody and then you injure his feelings. You injure his sense of self-respect, self-honor. The better thing would have been, you should have said some kind word to him and then asked his pardon and forgiveness. A kind word and forgiveness are better than charity followed by injury. Wallahu ghaniyyun haleem, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-sufficient. He doesn't need your help. He can feed and support his supporters. It's only a test for you that he has given you surplus wealth, whether you spend it for the cause of Allah or not. It's only a testing for you. Allah is not poor. Allah can support his supporters. Allah can maintain his armies himself. But you know, he's testing you. Wallahu ghaniyyun haleem. Allah is self-sufficient and he's forbearing. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu la tubtilu sadaqatikum bil manni wal adha. O you who believe, do not render vain your charity by mentioning your generosity and by injuring the feelings of those to whom you have given that charity. كَالَّذِي يُنْفِقُ مَعَلَهُ رِيَا النَّاسِ. In the same way as that person who is spending his money to show off to the people. وَلَا يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Whosoever is giving his money and spending his wealth to show off to the people so that they should praise him, he has no iman on Allah. وَلَا يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. He doesn't have any faith in Allah, nor does he believe in the last day. فَمَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ صَفْوَانِ. So it's his similitude or likeness is to the likeness of a very smooth rock. عَلَيْهِ تُرَابٌ. On it was, some dust was there. Someone, he cultivated in that dust. He put some seeds in that dust. Now a crop was there. He was hoping to have the harvest. But suddenly, فَأَصَابَهُ وَابِلٌ. A very strong and heavy rain fell and left it bare. Now everything was washed off because the clay was very shallow. Beneath it was very smooth rock. And on that shallow clay you had cultivated and you had put the seed and now the harvest was there. It has no roots. When a strong and heavy rain fell, everything was washed off. And now the rock was there bare. لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا. They have no control for which they labored. They labored so much, they cultivated, they spent, they put the seed there, but now everything is gone and they can have no control over any of their labor that they spent there. وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِ الْقَوْمَ الْكَافِرِينَ. This is the simile of who is spending their money or wealth only to show off their generosity to the people. Not real iman, or in the hereafter, they are not doing so sincerely for Allah and His pleasure. وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِ الْقَوْمَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't guide such people who are denying and who are denying the real faith. وَمَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ. The same principle of simultaneous contrast. They are opposed to such people which we have discussed before. مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ. The likeliness or similitude of those people who spend their money only to get the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتَثْبِيتًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. And they want strengthening of their own souls. I am spending so that Allah may be pleased and my spirit may be purified. Dual purpose can be there. You are spending for the cause of Allah so that Allah is pleased and your own soul, your own ruh, your own spirit is purified. Tazkiyah. That is why, you know, for this ibadah, for this mode of worship, particular mode of worship in which you give your money, that is called zakah. Purifying thing. It purifies the souls of the people. Tasbita min anfusihim. whosoever is spending their money in this way, for pleasing Allah and purification of their and strengthening of their souls, their example is kamasali jannatin birabwatin. Example or simile of a garden which is on a raised place. Asabaha wabilun. If there is strong rain, heavy rain, fa'atatukulaha dhifain, that garden gives the fruit twice, twofold. Fa'in lam yusibha wabilun, if there is not very heavy rain, faqal, then a small drizzle would also benefit the garden. The fruit will be there anyhow. The garden will not be washed away with the strong rain, because it is not on a smooth rock. It is there on a raised platform. Wallahu bima ta'amaluna basir, and whatever you are doing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is seeing it. Ayamaddu ahadukum. Does anybody amongst you like أن تكون له جنة, that there may be for him a garden, من نخيل وعناب, in that garden there may be the date palms and the grapes, the vines, تجري من تحت الأنهار, beneath that garden there are streams are flowing, له فيها من كل الثمرات, in that garden for him there are all types of food. وَأَصَابَهُ الْكِبَرُ, and now old age has overtaken him. So this is a simile. Just imagine a person, a very old person, he worked very hard, he cultivated plants, he prepared a garden, now he has a garden of date palms, then there are the many orchards and the vines, and everything is there, water is flowing, all sorts of fruits are there, and now the old age has overtaken him. وَلَهُ ذُرِّيَّةٌ ضُعَفَاءُ, and he, his progeny, his sons and daughters are weaklings, very young in age, they need protection. فَأَصَابَهَا إِعْصَارٌ, suddenly on some day, some occasion, a fiery whirlwind comes, strikes that garden, فَاحْتَرَقَتْ, and the whole garden got burnt up. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَفَكَّرُونَ, in this way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes his ayat plain for you, clear for you, so that you may ponder over them, you may reflect over them. Now this is actually simile, what is the lesson in it? A person has been doing charity and doing everything. Suddenly when he will be raised from the dead, he will find, I have done nothing because I was not sincere. Whatever I was doing only to get good name, good praise from the people, not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whosoever is doing any good work, any charity, for riya'ul nas, to show off to the people, he will find himself in the position of that old person whose whole life's hard labor has gone in one incident. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.